The final item of business is members' business debate on motion 22640 in the name of Alistair Allen on concerns regarding the island's housing market. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Alistair Allen to open the debate. Alistair Allen, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. All of Scotland's islands make their own distinctive cultural contribution to our country, but all of that depends on them being populated. And all islands face their own unique challenges, different geographies, different transport links and levels of average income. Today, though, I want to raise another island problem, and that is housing. Today's debate has been prompted by a campaign led by Padraig Morrison and a number of other young constituents in Uist. They all want to live in and contribute to the social and economic fabric of their island, perhaps to set up their own business or to croft. Some were born and raised in the islands and want to return. Others have migrated. Others still wish to. They've all identified the single biggest obstacle to these ambitions as being finding somewhere to live. Now, part of that solution here is social rented housing. There remains a housing waiting list of around 400 in the Western Isles. The Scottish Government's recent unprecedented offer of £25 million to build new houses locally, it will certainly make a very welcome impact on that. But we will also need to do that to have robust systems to measure demand for housing in rural areas, because almost by definition, no record of such demand exists in areas where there have been few, if any, socially rented houses to apply for. Unless we get that right, we do run the risk of building only in a few more urban areas. But islands, aside from the issue of rented housing, islands also face unique and growing problems when it comes to the supply of houses to buy. So let me explain what I mean by that by a couple of admittedly extreme examples. A small, I think it was a two-bedroomed house in a particularly scenic part of my constituency, recently sold for £385,000. A few miles up the road from it, the tenancy of a croft, and I should explain, by that I mean not the ownership of the land, but just the opportunity to take on the tenancy with its associated right to buy, was recently advertised for £200,000. That croft, I should stress, had as yet no house on it at all. I don't claim that these situations are typical of all areas across all islands. However, if this trend were to catch on, then as Patrick has pointed out, young families in the islands could abandon any prospect of ever buying a home. Patrick told me this. We have first-hand examples of young people, professionally qualified, putting in offers for houses. Despite communicating to sellers the importance of population retention, cash-rich buyers have sometimes jumped in front and bought houses which often have not been viewed. In the worst examples, the island has not yet even been visited by them. Now, there are multiple reasons for this rise in prices in some areas. Most recently, it has probably been partly driven by the entirely ill-founded idea that islands are somehow completely unaffected by COVID. More generally, however, the market has been distorted by the sharp rise in the number of second homes or short-term lets. Now, before I go further, let me make clear I am not making a case against tourism. In fact, I welcome tourism's recent growth in the islands, recognise that self-catering accommodation is a very important part of it, and nor am I having a go at the required. But, Presiding Officer, there do also have to be some houses in the islands available to buy at a reasonable price by people who want to live there all year round during their working lives. In parts of Harris, holiday homes and second homes now account between them for almost 60% of all houses. The same, I understand, is also perhaps becoming true in Tyree, among other places. There are some communities in my constituency, and I stress only some, where there are now no new children entering primary schools. No affordable housing ultimately means closed schools. And this is a point underlined by a report published today by Community Land Scotland on community-led housing. This has found the lack of access to affordable housing for local people is exacerbated by increasing numbers of houses being turned into holiday homes and short-term lets. And the report also highlights just how valuable communities have found the Rural and Islands Housing Funds in terms of getting affordable housing to where it is needed. And I would be grateful, perhaps, if the Minister was able to speak to the future of these funds in his closing remarks. Unless there be any room for any willful misunderstanding here, let me also be clear, nobody is making a case against people moving to the islands. I am an incomer to the islands myself, a fact I seem to remember being raised politically in some quarters, if to little effect, during the election of 2007. In fact, the islands desperately need more new people, even just to fill the job vacancies which are projected to come up over the next few years. The islands are a wonderful and welcoming place to live. The point is that we need a diverse mix of people of different ages, skills and backgrounds to ensure we have an adequate workforce. One of the biggest obstacles to achieving that, cited by many employers, is a lack of housing. So I welcome the measures which the Scottish Government is presently consulting on to give local authorities the power to regulate the number of short-term lets in any single community. And I would personally make the case for a similar power to regulate the number of second homes too. Now, I realise that I've come to this debate without a list of detailed solutions, but I think it's only fair to give a public airing to the fears that many communities quietly but increasingly do now express to me, places that want to retain the vitality that marks out a community from a resort. However, we can look to other places for ideas. In Norway, for example, I understand that many rural areas operate two entirely separate housing markets. One is a list of houses that are available for sale as year-round residences only. And I believe that Cornwall and other places have made efforts to try to ensure that similar issues are dealt with there. Increasing the level of support for the open market shared equity or other area-based limits for four apartment houses in the Western Isles being standing at £100,000, for instance, at the moment, are perhaps all issues we could look at. We certainly, in my view, do need to think about placing certain restrictions on those grants which are designed specifically to bring empty homes back into the local housing market, to ensure that these properties are not then used for holiday or second homes. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, whatever solutions we do arrive at, I hope we can agree across the Chamber that Patrick and his friends have given us some pretty convincing reasons why we cannot leave the future of our communities in the Highlands and Islands to the mercy of an unrestrained free market on houses.
Thank you very much, Mr. Allen. In case you didn't hear, you got a wee clap there. I'll now move on to the open debate. Speeches of around 4 minutes, please. Now, I'm aware that because of the late start, Mr. Gibson has to leave us fairly soon. So we'll first of all have Kenneth Gibson, followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I congratulate my colleague Alistair Allen for bringing this debate to the Chamber, as I know this is a topic of real concern for the communities he represents. And I also appreciate the Presiding Officer allowing me to leave before the end of the debate because of the late start and because I actually have a meeting to discuss ferry matters with my island constituents. In the motion was the threat of losing Gaelic as a living local language. That threat is all too real, as my own constituency demonstrates. The 1901 census indicated that 50 to 74% of West Ham's population spoke Gaelic and 25 to 49% in the East. Yet by 1992, Anna's last native speaker had sadly passed away. Such a loss must be prevented in Gaelic's Western Isles heartland. I've raised the issue of island depopulation in the Chamber before, and island constituents continue to contact me about it. Over decades, there's been an ongoing shift in island demography due to new incoming residents, often financially established and able to buy family homes with relative ease, having an economic advantage over Indigenous working-age islanders who cannot compete on price, causing young islanders to move to the mainland, often never to return. And now only around a third of the 4,600 islanders are native following such displacement. While newcomers often have skills and infuse the community with energy and ideas, they are disproportionately elderly. A huge number of properties are now second or holiday homes, where planning restrictions further diminish options available. The lack of affordable housing for younger people makes it more difficult to fill the demand for workers, particularly in health and social care settings, including care at home. I sympathise with the suggestion of a tiered system whereby properties are first advertised only locally, but how could such a system be implemented where it impacts on a private transaction? An owner wishing to move on always wants the best price possible. Measures to encourage folk to sell local are worth exploring. However, a better way to counter the shortage is to build more affordable homes. I was delighted when the Scottish Government awarded £3.612 million to Arran Development Trust last year from its Rural and Islands Housing Fund. New build at Brathwick Terrace in Brodick has a total budget of £6.5 million. It was the largest grant awarded to a community group from this fund and is part of a wider £8.5 million package to provide 43 affordable homes for rent. Arran Development Trust has also applied for £400,000 from the Scottish Land Fund to buy development land at River Den, and I wish them every success with their application. Nevertheless, continuing to build properties while others lie empty is not sustainable or desirable. Particularly in West Arran, there are numerous private properties that require more investment than many sellers or potential buyers can afford. Who will modernise, rewire, replumb homes still in the same condition as in the 1960s or 70s? Such properties often don't even make it onto the market, falling into further disrepair. Through Home Energy Scotland, the Scottish Government has made up to £38,500 per home available to make energy efficiency improvements. And while it's enormously helpful that grants are available and loans are interest-free, they're only available to owner-occupiers, and properties needing the most work often cannot be occupied before renovation is complete. Improved grants for conversion and restrictions on which properties receive grants so they can't be used for holiday or second homes would be helpful, as would a fund to purchase such homes, which tend to be scattered around islands for social rent, rather than affordable homes only in mini housing schemes. In 2013, Scottish ministers provided local authorities with discretion to vary council tax on unoccupied properties, a measure which saved those renovating or trying to sell thousands of pounds. Initially, a discount of between 10 and 50% is required, but once a property is unoccupied for 12 months, 24 months if actively marketed for sale or let, an increase of up to 100% may be imposed to encourage owners to bring the home back into use. However, while guidance provides discretion to consider the location a dwelling is in and examine the circumstances case by case, evidence to the Local Government and Communities Committee shows that some local authorities do not exercise enough flexibility, even where empty homes officers are in post. A scheme to reduce single occupancy and under-occupied housing through incentives and elderly-friendly housing developments would also help. Presiding Officer, we value Scotland's island communities and must enable young people to stay on their beautiful islands, raise children and sustain their communities and culture.
Move on to Edward Mountain, to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking Alistair Allen for bringing this important debate this evening. It's not a debate I intended to speak to when I got up this morning, but when I thought about it a bit more, it actually came to me that this was actually something that had really been driven home to us on the REC committee when we'd visited various islands as part of the Islands Bill. So from the outset, I'd like to know that I am very sympathetic to many of the points raised by Alistair Allen and firmly agree that action must be taken to stop the rural depopulation. And part of that action definitely involves housing, though this is not the silver bullet to the overarching problems that cause rural depopulation. It is an important issue nonetheless, and it should be taken seriously. As Alistair Allen notes in his motion, there's been a significant uptake in property interest in the Western Isles, and indeed across much of the Highlands and Islands region during the COVID-19 pandemic, with interest not only from England, but from countries further afield, including Hong Kong. Much of this has been described as urban flight and in reaction to people looking to be away from densely populated areas during the pandemic. And while all members in this Parliament, I'm sure, welcome migration, we know from experience that all too often property is purchased in our region and not lived in, as Dr. Allen has mentioned, on a permanent basis, but either to be lived in for a few weeks of the year or to be rented out for others visiting temporarily. Of course, I accept tourism is important for the economy of the Highlands and Islands, but it cannot and should not come at the detriment to those who live and work in the region and who have families there. According to the Scottish Government's National Island Plan, the population of Orkney and Shetland is set to fall by 2.2% by 2041, and while that of the Western Isles is set to fall by a staggering 14%, and that to me is deeply worrying. And I'm also aware of the worries and concerns expressed by those living in our island communities across Argyll and Bute and the Highlands. While it is clear and evident that there is a problem with housing being bought up to be used as holiday homes or for self-catering accommodation, for example, it is also clear we are not building enough new houses and affordable houses in our island communities. I know from casework there are many empty properties, such as old and neglected crofting homes, that could be brought back into use and have not yet been done so. Part of the problem appears to be the ineffectiveness of the Rural Housing Fund and the Island Housing Fund. While its intentions appear good, a recent Freedom of Information response showed that both schemes have delivered a total of only 68 new homes in the last 4 years, well short of the target of 500 houses, which should have been delivered by the Rural Housing Fund alone. Now, I'm led to understand that the Rural Housing Fund uses a cost per unit of £83,000 for affordable housing, despite, as Dr. Allen, I'm sure, will know, the costs of building a house on an island are much, much higher. And this maybe have to be raised so that we can afford to build more affordable homes across the islands. In addition to building more affordable homes, I think we need to be more mindful of the need for more social housing in our island communities. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, I reiterate my thanks to Dr. Allen for bringing forward this motion today. And I think we can spark a wider debate in Civic Scotland about how best we can preserve our populations in rural and remote parts of the country. Our solutions have to be innovative, and it is clear that the creation of new, quality, affordable housing will be key to that. And hopefully this debate will stimulate that conversation. And I look forward to taking forward some of the ideas that have been mentioned here this evening. Presiding Officer.
Rhoda Grant, followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too want to congratulate Alistair Allen for securing this debate tonight. And can I also pay tribute to the young people he talked about in his speech who raised this issue recently with many of us. They were highlighting their own experience trying to find affordable housing in island and rural communities. They contacted us again this week saying the situation was getting worse. Young people who moved away for further and higher education want to come home and can't. Young people who want to live and work in the communities that they were brought up in. There are also young people being forced out because jobs and salaries available locally mean that they can't compete with those who have spare cash for a holiday home. They are at the beginning of their careers and have not accumulated the wealth to compete with those who can afford a second home. When I visited West Harris Trust, they told me when they bought the estate, there were fears that nearly half of the local housing would become second homes. So not surprisingly, their top priority was building houses. And we've seen many community landowners do the same, and indeed communities who don't own their land setting up trusts to be able to build houses. And therefore, Community Land Scotland's report on this very issue published today is timely. But sadly, it's not a new problem. It's been a problem for decades, but it is getting worse. And it causes the breakup of communities and families, with young people being forced to leave, causing a brain drain and depopulation. COVID-19 has made this worse by impacting on the economy of rural and island communities. That has a greater disparity between local people who can afford and those who, due to the pandemic, have even more spending power and can afford these houses. The young people who wrote to us expressing their concerns about access to homes asked that houses for sale be advertised locally before being advertised further afield as holiday homes. And this has merit, especially given they highlighted in their submissions to us that this worked well in one case they quoted. But we could go further, and Alistair Allen mentioned Norway, but this happens in the Channel Islands as well, where they operate two housing markets. We could have a holiday home market that is proportionate to the local housing available in the local housing market. Every home that was built with the assistance from the public purse could only be available to locals, and this would include things like council houses, housing association houses, homes built with the help of the Crofting Housing Grant and other public incentives. And people could also opt into the local housing market, making clear their view that their home should become indeed a family home. And we also need opportunities for building houses. The Crofting Housing Grants scheme is not really fit for purpose. It doesn't reflect that those who need who are running crofts also need other employment opportunities as well. And too often I've heard of young people being turned down by the scheme because they want to include an extra bedroom for bed and breakfast, an office for a different job or a workshop, depending on what they do. And this needs to be put right. We also need to ensure that young people in rural areas have access to good quality, well-paid jobs to allow them to get the mortgages they need to compete. And therefore, I would ask that the Scottish Government protect good quality jobs in rural areas, such as those of air traffic controllers in our islands and rural communities. Simply not good enough that these jobs are taken out of our communities and with them young families. The very survival of Gaelic depends on growing communities of Gaelic speakers, and again, depends on a solution to this problem. The Scottish Government Depopulation Task Force has not met since January earlier this year, and this needs to be given priority. We need to look at decentralising civil service jobs, encouraging public bodies to ensure their staffing structure supports our rural communities. We can't wait. This work needs to be carried out urgently. To do nothing will fail our island communities.
John Finney, please, to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And can I join others in congratulating Alistair Allen and bringing this very important motion before us? There's nothing more important than housing. Everyone needs to live somewhere, and hopefully that somewhere is a home. Like others, I'm keen to see responsible tourism in the Highlands, but no one needs the holiday in a home. I'm not a fan of the term second home or holiday home. It's an additional property. A home is something entirely different. And we must set that language against many who have no home or indeed no prospect of a home. Now, the motion it talks about the island's housing market, and I'm very keen to separate market forces. The problem that we're dealing with is about market forces. I'm keen to separate that from the fundamental human need, the human need for shelter, and indeed the role that the state plays in the provision of that. Good quality social housing. So, like Dr. Allen, I'm pleased that these millions have gone to the Western Isles for additional housing, but it's a drop in the ocean. And we know that kind of campaign, Patrick, and commend Patrick and the other campaigners for their work. We know that rural housing is closely linked to population retention. It's not exclusive to the islands, not the Northern Islands or the Western Islands. I'm from rural Lochaber, and there's far more housing there than there was when I was a boy, but there's no school, there's no post office. It's not the nature of the occupant. Properties that were previously tied to jobs, be that an estate or more commonly the forestry or the hydro, they were sold off. Therein lies a problem. Now, the statutory obligation for assessing housing needs lies with the local authority. And like Dr. Allen, I would be very keen that there's the broadest consideration taken. I had a look at the Outer Hebrides Local Housing Strategy 2017-2022. It's got all the right words, and indeed they're all in the right order. But we do hear from Community Land Scotland's report that islanders fear economic clearance. And I think there is some justification for that. We also hear that young islanders could not compete with offers made by buyers from elsewhere in the UK. And I say again, the problem is market forces. Why should they? We should be housing our population. In the north of Mull, there's loads of houses, plenty of houses, very few homes, plenty of houses. So we know, and my colleague Rhoda Grant touched on the West Harris Trust, and it became involved for this very reason. Daffa Community Trust said, we refuse to sleepwalk into becoming a retirement village. They've done great work there. 20 first affordable houses in 21 years, seven families, makes the school resilient. There's lots of suggestions what we can do. A number of them that have been shared with us. I think there are limitations to some of them. I think it's short-term let control areas, something that my colleague Andy Whiteman's thought about, and planning requirements for that would be very important. Decentralisation of jobs. Well, we're conducting the business of Parliament sitting in our houses, many of us. There's no reason why many of the jobs that have been undertaken in the public sector from the home henceforth can't be considered. Jobs and houses go very, very much hand in hand. The importance of this issue to the Gaelic language can't be underestimated. We need a massive house building programme. We need to involve the targeting of Highlands and Islands enterprise, a focus on people. Any impact assessment, as demanded by Ireland's legislation, suggests we do that anyway. So let's house our island populations. Let's protect and sustain the heart of the Gaeltacht. Hugh Ross from the Staff and Community Trust said, the sound, and I quote here, the sound of children playing in the gardens will be a very welcome noise, that of a community with a bright future. Agujerif, yes indeed. Thank you, President Officer.
Thank you. And the last of the open debate contributions is from Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank Alistair Allan for securing this debate. It's a hugely important issue and I'm pleased we're able to debate it today. While I know this debate appears to have been inspired by issues that may be more immediate in the Western Isles, the motion recognises availability of affordable housing is absolutely essential if young people are to make the islands their home and also to prevent population decline. It's right that a strategic objective is in the National Islands Plan. And on that note, I'd be interested if the Minister was able to give an update on progress in that area. Housing issues can be some of the most challenging and frustrating casework we receive, and I'm sure other members will feel the same. Shetland is my home and it matters to me. It's a beautiful part of the world, but beautiful scenery alone isn't enough to encourage skilled workers to make the move north. And there are skills shortages. Efforts to invest, develop and attract the highly skilled workforce that will be needed for Shetland's just transition will be wasted if people don't have the opportunity to make a home in the islands and contribute to our long economy for the long term. I know of people that relocated to Shetland to fill job vacancies, but unfortunately might now have to leave the islands because they can't afford the high private rents or face a long wait for social housing in their chosen area. I know two of families that are keen to return to Shetland to work and raise their children there, but are experiencing similar issues. And Alistair Allan is right, a lack of housing impacts on the viability of schools and other services. This is no criticism of local authority staff who are working hard to do the best for people with the resources they have. There are long-standing issues across the country with changing demographics and under-occupancy. Affordable housing is more than just a physical building. The cost of living in Shetland is up to 60% higher than the UK average, and fuel poverty is high. So it's vital that homes are energy efficient and that people are able to get a good broadband connection and mobile signal where they live. This year, more than ever, has demonstrated how essential that is. Island living is impossible without good transport links, inter-island, as well as lifeline connections to the mainland. Often when there is social housing available, it may not be in areas close to family and friends and work, or bus timetables don't work for people who work shifts. If government invests in our most remote communities, that can change. Properly addressing housing issues needs joined-up thinking on the private market, social housing provision, engagement with local community groups, and of course, between local and national government. Community groups need to be able to make use of the Island Housing Fund. Development trusts have often struggled with administrative barriers to this kind of funding. And I know that no homes have been built in Shetland so far using the scheme. The Island Housing Fund should open doors, literally and figuratively, for people in communities like mine. The Scottish Government must do far more to remove these obstacles and support communities in developing applications. We also need a commitment from ministers not to claw back much needed resources in the event that projects take a little longer to deliver. The government should also be looking at providing incentives to make sure many of the neglected and vacant properties across the country are renovated and brought up to an acceptable standard. There is an opportunity to ensure island communities get the affordable housing they need, and the Scottish Government can do more to help them seize that opportunity. Thank you.
I now call on Kevin Stewart to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and plaudits to Dr. Allen for bringing this debate forward today. It is often areas of rural Scotland that are classed as the best places, the happiest places, and of course the most beautiful places. But as Dr. Allen and others have highlighted, rural living also brings certain challenges, including larger numbers of second homes, and often has communities with people with lower incomes. And there has for far too long, in some places, been a lack of affordable homes, which can, of course, have major effects on accessing housing. We, without doubt, need to grow the Scottish economy, and we need to sustain our rural and island communities to support both communities and businesses, as well as the tourism sector, to thrive. We need to protect and safeguard the diverse and cultural characteristics of communities while supporting a place-based approach to rural development. And during the consultations for the National Islands Plan, concerns that island communities had on the issue of depopulation were made clear. And in response, the National Islands Plan published last year includes specific commitments seeking to address population decline and to ensure a healthy, balanced population profile. This supports our wider commitment to publish a population strategy looking at Scotland's demographic challenges as a whole in early 2021. And we are also committed to supporting our rural and island communities through our reform to the planning system and recognise the critical role that appropriate housing can play. The Planning Scotland Act 2019 introduced new duties for planning to help increase the population of rural areas of Scotland, particularly in depopulated areas. And we have also begun the process of developing National Planning Framework 4, and we're exploring new proactive policy options for planning to enable development that supports dynamic rural economies and helps to sustain and support our rural communities. But I would also appeal to those elected members in island communities or remote rural communities, be brave when you are sitting on the planning committee making decisions. Be brave, make sure that you are voting for the right development to take place to help folk in your community. We also, Presiding Officer, have an important planning consultation closing tomorrow on our proposals for extending permitted development rights. And the proposed changes would increase the range of developments that can be carried out without the need for a full planning application. We know that good quality affordable housing is essential to help attract and retain people in Scotland's remote rural and island communities. And also that providing affordable housing in these areas presents different challenges than that in urban areas. A small number of homes can make a big difference in terms of sustainability to a local economy. Now, our affordable housing supply programme supports the delivery of affordable housing for rent or purchase across urban and rural areas of Scotland. The programme has grant subsidy levels, which recognise these rural challenges. And Edward Minton mentioned subsidy levels in his speech. There is flexibility built into all that we do, because we recognise that building in remote rural and island communities is more costly. And that flexibility of the grant subsidy levels has led to projects which would never have taken place if we'd had a fixed approach. Places that have benefited are the likes of Alva Ferry in Mull, or Horgebost in West Harris, which Dr. Allen is well aware of. So whilst we encourage maximising value when it comes to delivering affordable housing, the higher cost of rural and islands development is very well understood. This government is committed to affordable housing, having now delivered nearly 96,000 affordable homes since 2007. And until COVID-19, we were on track to deliver on our commitment to deliver 50,000 affordable homes this Parliament. And some of those homes are in the likes of Shetland, King Harold Street, a new development that is just about to be completed, and Gaeta Ghaut, which I'm sure Beatrice Wishart is well aware of. And I take my hat off to Yatland Housing Association for the work that they have done in bringing forward more difficult sites like Staney Hill, for example. And in the first year of this Parliament, the Affordable Housing Supply Programme has delivered over 4,800 affordable homes in rural and island areas. And we've invested over £55 million in the islands alone. As has been pointed out already, we brought into play the Rural and Islands Housing Funds to address some of the challenges associated with the provision of housing in rural Scotland. We launched that £30 million fund in 2016, and that complements our existing significant investment in affordable housing in rural areas. And many will have seen the Community Land Scotland report today, written by David Ross, which highlights the benefits that there have been to many families across rural and island Scotland because of the investment from this fund. Now, I recognise that some people think that investment from the fund has been too slow, but we have had to allow communities to develop at their own pace the schemes that are essential for them. And it is extremely important that these schemes are community-led and they have the backing of and the support of organisations like Community Land Scotland. Provision of housing through these funds, which are available to a wider range of housing providers, continues to grow, increasing the supply of affordable housing in remote rural Scotland and in our islands. And as I've said, given the long lead-in times and the complexities involved with rural housing development, it is encouraging to see momentum of these funds, and we have built steadily from a standing start with real progress in the number of homes approved in the last couple of years. One or two homes in a small community is as important as a large-scale development in a city. And for example, I visited a small development last summer, funded by our Islands Housing Fund at Gravier in the Isle of Lewis. And that development is hugely important in allowing that community to grow. I recognise that the Rural and Islands Housing Fund is delivering for rural communities and providing an additional funding route for those not able to access traditional affordable housing funding. And I agree with the assessment of Savills and their work for the Scottish Land Commission, where they describe the funds as a game changer, a positive view reflected through a recent review of the funds. And Presiding Officer, I'm therefore pleased to announce the continuation of the Rural and Islands Housing Fund beyond March 2021, with up to £30 million available to support this demand-led scheme as part of the future five-year affordable housing programme. I hope this will be welcomed by members here tonight and be recognised as part of our commitment to rural and island housing. While in many areas of rural Scotland, tourism contributes positively to local economies and to communities, we recognise that in certain areas, particularly tourist hotspots, high numbers of short-term lets can make it harder for people to find homes to live in. And this is why on the 14th of September, we published a consultation paper setting out our detailed proposals for the regulation of short-term lets in Scotland. The consultation will gather final views on the new legislation, giving local authorities powers to license short-term lets and introduce control areas before regulations are laid in Parliament in December, which will come into force in April of 2021. Looking forward, Presiding Officer, we're working on a vision for how our homes and communities should look and feel in 2040 and the options and choices that we need to make to get us there. We want to ensure that everyone in Scotland has access to a high-quality, sustainable home that is safe, warm, affordable, and meets their needs. And we have consulted widely with communities across rural, urban, and island locations so that we can plot a route map and put that route map in place that will stand the test of time. We want to create a shared vision for housing that covers all of Scotland, cities, towns, lowlands, highlands, and islands. And as a government, we are committed to doing all that we can to help rural communities thrive. We remain committed to working with our rural island communities. We will continue to listen on issues such as council tax, land and buildings transaction tax, and some of the pressures that are on. We will continue to develop and to deliver solutions that are needed for different rural and island populations. Presiding Officer, as Scotland's Housing Minister, I have made it part of my wish list to ensure that we drive up housing in all of Scotland. I've had the great pleasure of visiting many, many places, remote, rural and island, to see what we have done, but also to see what is required. And I will continue to do so as long as I am in this post. Once again, thank you to Dr. Allen for bringing this debate to the Chamber tonight.
Thank you very much, Minister. That was quite a 7 minutes that we had there, but all very interesting. Thank you. And that concludes the debate, and this meeting is closed.